Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Live at the Whiskey Lounge. Take off my specs. I can see better without them, actually. Welcome. My name is Steve Rashid. I'm your host for the evening. Well, there's Larry. Hi, Larry. We do this every Thursday. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for supporting live music and particularly for supporting live this series. We're thrilled that you're here. We obviously couldn't do it without human beings in the room, so it's really great when we do have bodies in here. This started about a year and a half ago. I forgot to look before I came up, but I believe this is our 83rd or 84th show. We do it every Thursday, and short of, you know, holidays, like we won't have one on Thanksgiving. But you do have these little table cards in front of you, and you're welcome to take them. Please feel free to take them, and there's a newsletter sign up on there if you like. I won't spam you, I promise. The email comes directly from me to you, and I only send one per week, and it usually gives you a little something you can click on so you can hear an example of the artist coming up and just remind you of what's happening. But again, thank you for coming. You'll see a lot of technology up here. Superfluous technology, but it's actually not. We have a lot of microphones here, and these little guys are cameras. We do a live recording of every single show, multi-track recording like we would do in a recording studio, and we also have cameras. My good friend Carl is over here running the video end of things, and we do a live video stream of every show. So if you can't be here, of course, we're sorry when you can't be here, but when you can't, if you'd like to tune in, you can watch us online. We're streaming right now live. I think we are, Carl. Did someone hit go on that thing? Oh, that's good, because I forgot. So we stream live on the internet again. Information about that is on those table cards as well. So, and if you have friends in other areas, you're welcome to let them know, and they can tune in as well. We've been viewed at this point, last time I checked, close to 40,000 views in 158 countries. I mean, literally kind of all over the place. So it's kind of crazy. I don't know how they find us. You're obviously not here to hear me talk. I'm going to get out of the way, but I will come back at the end of the first set, do a little Q&A with John and Larry, and get to know them a little better, and invite your questions as well. But you are here to hear two true masters. I've really been looking forward to this. John, I've known for many, many years, and Larry, I've known as well, although I have to admit, not as well as I know John. John and I, well, we can tell stories about this later, but we've met, it has to be at least 10 years ago, maybe, 14, yeah. 14, yeah, yeah, a lot of years like ago. two true masters of their art. And their craft. They both have performed here, but never together. And I'm very fond of this. These very small ensembles, just duets and trios. You can hear the conversations. You can hear them literally interacting. In fact, I've got a question I'm going to catalog for now that I want to ask you about one of the pieces that you were doing during sound check that I hope you do during the first set. You will hear two true masters here, and thank you so much for your kind attention. Again, because we're recording, we do ask you, if you are going to speak to your neighbors, please keep the volume low because we record these. Oh, and one really great announcement that I have to make. We edit some of these shows down and broadcast them on WDCB, which we have a great relationship with. I've just put together a holiday show that will be airing in a couple times in December. In fact, John is one of the performers who played on this, some stuff that we recorded last December. But starting in January, we're going to have a weekly radio show on WDCB. It's going to be from 7 to 8 every Tuesday, and it's going to be edited versions of these shows that we've been recording, all these 80-some shows that we've got. So we'll have a regular outlet for these, and we'll be distributing that to other markets. So kind of exciting that this stuff is living, and we'll be exporting Chicago jazz to other places. Anyway, enough for me. I'm getting out of the way. Thank you, thank you, thank you. John Moulder, Larry Gray. We'll get to know them a little bit later. Thank you.
Very much. So nice to have such a great crowd tonight. Really is feels great to have you all here. So we're excited to play together. That last composition was a tune that I wrote shortly after had an experience as a teacher where I went into the registrar's office and the head guy who does a lot of, who's, I guess, what would you call him, the head registrar, as it were, said, what class are you teaching? I'm like, rock history on Monday night, 6 to 9. He goes, how many kids in there? He guys said, 30. He goes, that's Battle Pay. So that's the name of this song, is Battle Pay. on another note, we're going to play a composition, beautiful, slower composition called Sorrow. And
thank you. So we decided, is this on? There we go. Yeah. So we decided to play a standard now at this point. Thanks for getting into our meditative zone that we just happen to be in right now. And that piece was, I composed that in the early 1990s. I'm not that old. Yeah. And it was recorded beautifully on an album. My first record in 1993 was called Solo Plus Quartet. As a fantastic interpretation, if you get a chance, by Ed Peterson, Mike Coker, and Joel Spencer. And so John and I decided to do it tonight. So now we're going to do something that you undoubtedly mostly know and love, and it's called Stella by Starlight. Thank you. John has requested a tune we've never played before, a composition of mine with the unlikely title of Not Knowing What He Really Wanted. I'm not saying it was autobiographical, but it's just a thought, just a title. It could be about anyone, really, but I won't say anything more about the influences. But you maybe we'll talk about it in the interview. Who knows?
Yeah.
Because you like this at the sound check. Yeah, this album. Yeah. You ready?
Yeah, I've been ready.
Okay.
Let's try it.
Okay. Looks like that. Ready?
Yeah. Time because I'm not getting any volume. I don't know, Steve. I know you were looking over here.
Yeah, sure. What's up?
Maybe it's something that's here. Hold on.
Dynamics.
That helps, doesn't it? Much better. Yeah. All right. Let's try that again.
Now we're going to play. No.
We're going to play. Not knowing what he wanted
not
to play.
What he...
All right. Yeah, get an acoustic sound. Okay, we're going to do a guitar change here.
And a new original of John's, a very user-friendly piece that he calls Calypso. So we'll see. For this, he needs another instrument.
This is all part of our meticulously planned show.
We should hurry up.
No.
Here we go.
Okay.
So, Steve. How's that for a little accessibility?
Making this up as we go along. We're going to continue right now with a composition by a great bass player and musician. Some of you may or may not know his name, but his name, he's a bird-like fellow. His name is Steve Swallow, and he played with Gary Burton, and he's one of the great composers. He's also been married for years to another great, great jazz composer who was just honored by, what's it called, Jim? Is it the Monk Institute or the... NEA Jazz Master. That's what, yeah. NEA Jazz Master, that'd be Carla Bley. So Carla Bley and Steve Swallow are a great team. So this is a pretty well-known, probably the most common of Steve Swallow's compositions. Hopefully we won't sound, no. It's called, a beautiful, beautiful song, think about the title, Falling Grace. Falling Grace by Steve Swallow. Are we straight A's? Thank you.
I misheard the cue.
Is that about right?
Isn't this fantastic? Wow, it's just transporting. I'm going to see. Let me see if I can sneak back there so I'm not blocking you guys.
Come on, man.
What could possibly go wrong? Excellent.
There's a lot of gear for a couple of guys.
I know. Well, I know, exactly. You know, and I have to say, this. I'm going to be totally honest here. Thursdays are long days for me. Because I bring this stuff from my studio, so I usually start. I'm usually packing up by about 2 p.m, and I usually am wrapping up by about midnight or 1 by the time I've got everything unpacked and files backed up and everything kind of set on the website. And it's a long day, so there are days on Thursdays that I sort of don't look forward to because it's. I just, and in fact, every Thursday is a little bit of a struggle to get started, and then I get here. And this happens, and I think, oh my God, I would do this every day. I mean, I really, it's really just so great. You know, a million thoughts were rattling around my head as I was sitting over there, and I want to keep this somewhat concise, but I do wonder about, you guys are both such, not only such incredible players, but such strong composers. And oftentimes, I will talk to people about their playing, but I don't often talk about people's composition styles. And you brought up something. You know, when you were doing the sound check on that piece, and tell me again, Larry, what the name of that, what the title of that piece was. Actually, talking to the mic, if you would, so people in the 158 countries can hear you.
Sure. Hello.
So the title of that piece that you referred
that three,
to.
That three piece, you mean not knowing what he wanted?
Yes, I think it was in six or three or
whatever.
Who's
counting?
Yeah.
We are.
Yeah.
That's what we're feeling.
Or five.
Right, exactly. Or five sometimes. So the name of the piece was what?
Not knowing what he wanted.
Not knowing what he wanted. And when you were in the sound check playing it, first of all, my reaction when I first heard it was that it sounds very filmic. I mean, it just sounded like it belonged in a film. Very cinematic. But you made a comment to John as you were running. You said, this is questions and answers.
Okay.
And I thought that was so apt because you would, and so much of this is so conversational when it's this teeny little ensemble like this. But it was literally a bar.
It ends with a question.
Yeah, right. So was that part of your compositional process? Were you actually thinking that? Or
it's difficult to go back and dissect, but I don't know. I wrote that at the piano. There were probably some different influences, probably like thinking of Randy Weston playing like a solo piano kind of vibe where it's not necessarily jazz, but it had an African kind of sensibility to it.
Yeah.
And it came out of, I like this Ethiopian restaurant around here, and the music that they play in there is a lot of West African. I guess it's from Mali or different places.
This place on Chicago?
Well, there's a bunch of them on Broadway.
Oh, okay, got it. Mm-hmm.
But it's a genre where it'll be a saxophone, electric bass, and drums, and that electric bass is playing some kind of ostinato. So that was kind of like where that was originally coming from. I originally had it. I first recorded it with saxophone. You know, with Ed Peterson and probably Robert Shai and myself, I've recorded it a bunch of times. It's been through a bunch of installments, but those are the main elements probably.
Wow. And John, the Calypso song that you played, or the piece that you played, that was not so John Moulder like.
I know, that's very true. I will say that. Yeah. So I decided
to talk to us
try.
About that.
Yeah. I decided to try. To bring here anyway a couple of compositions that were unlike what I usually write.
Uh-huh.
So that Calypso one, I don't know where that came from. It was just kind of goofing around with muted guitar. And sorry, I didn't really, I wasn't hearing it direct back, so I'm not sure how that came across. But anyway, that's where that, you know, came from. It was more like an exercise in trying to, you know, mute the guitar. Mm-hmm, and then it just turned into that piece. I thought, I'll write it down. And it would, you know, I thought that it would be a cool environment to do it as a duo more than anything else.
Yeah.
You know, it's a little more intimate and that type of thing. But then, also the blues, you know, that's, it might be the first blues that I've written. So that was also something a little unusual. You'll hear a song that we're going to do later called Petals that's more characteristic of usually the way I write.
Uh-huh. So, you know, you said that it almost like an exercise, and I was thinking, I know, Larry, you have a great background in classical music as well as jazz, mm-hmm. and
sure.
John,
that's
I assume
right.
you as well. Are you a classical guitarist?
No, I had a teacher when I was younger that played quite a bit of classical guitar, in fact, primarily, so I got a lot of right string, or right finger, you know, kind of studies that way,
mm-hmm.
so.
And I was thinking about your playing is so... you know, my buddy, I can't tell you how often I think of my buddy Don Sternberg, who always seems to come up with a funny line. But
oh, yeah.
But we were, I forget who we were with, but it was a bass player, and he said, there's no damn frets on the thing. You know, you know, you seem to extend the range of the instrument because you were playing in tune all the way to the... I mean, to the possible limit, and
trying, man. Scales every day, you know.
Well, do you attribute? I mean, it's so in tune. Is it? You attribute any of that to classical training, or some, or a lot of it, or any?
Well,
of it?
I mean, yeah, training for sure. I like to say, Gary Bart says there's one kind of music, and it's called music.
Yeah, right.
But absolutely, yeah. I mean, there's no reason for us to be narrow in our focus. You
absolutely.
Know? And so when you want to go to, when you're talking about playing a string instrument, with what you just talked about, I mean, there's no, you know, there's just wood.
Right.
And you have to find those points. So the basic, you know, the so-called classical tradition, you got to go there. You can't avoid that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think. It would be different.
Yeah. Well, and you know, and I completely agree. I mean, wasn't it Duke Ellington that said there are two kinds of music: good music,
and bad music,
and the other
yeah.
kind. Yeah.
Yeah.
But
sure. But classical training is a heavy part of
my
background.
And there are, you know, I mean, it's useful to have categories just to describe languages
about it.
I didn't mean vocabulary.
To be
I know.
Au contraire.
but do you? There are many people that feel very comfortable in one part of that music world and not at all in the other, and,
sure.
and from on both sides, right?
Yeah, right.
But you seem to straddle them very comfortably. I mean, you play a lot of classical gigs as well?
Well, it's gone. I haven't lately. You know, we tend to get pigeonholed as things go, but through the years I have, sure.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, and I also studied cello, and so that experience.
I knew that. And you started as a guitarist, didn't you?
You don't want to know. I started as an accordionist.
Ah, great.
But
now we're getting somewhere.
I rapidly evolved to the guitar. But I still have the accordion in my basement, and I do pull it out at times.
So usually it takes about 20 minutes for us to get down to the really good
it's
stuff.
True,
so
yeah.
Let's talk about accordion.
Yeah, absolutely.
But
the strings came later. It was really, uh-huh. that stuff came later, man. You know, uh-huh. to find
you needed something larger and heavier to carry around.
So much. Yeah.
According,
yeah.
it wasn't quite heavy enough.
And I found some good teachers too.
Oh yeah,
I found a couple of the
well,
greatest,
and that helps,
the greatest
doesn't
mentors,
it?
Really.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah. John, what? Tell me a little bit about your training coming up. How did you become? This is maybe too simplistic a question, but you have evolved into a really distinctive style. And did it come through very specific influences, or how can you give a Cliff Notes version of how that
you
came
know,
about?
That's a good question.
I have
a good friend of mine who's known me since I was in high school, and he claims he can hear aspects of my playing now from back then. So
wow.
I don't know if some of it was just the way I heard music at the beginning, but certainly training. I mean, I would say. Maybe an unusual chronology. I didn't like start with more the kind of straight ahead, more traditional jazz. My interests were immediately more on the modern side of things. I kind of went back and retraced some of that later, but was always fascinated with where some of the modern music and harmonic directions were going. So
well, isn't that also
that's intrigued me from the start. So I think.
Isn't that also kind of funny sometimes when something would just grab you musically,
yeah.
and then you latch onto that, and you sort of like jumping midstream somewhere,
yeah.
and then you have to step back and say, where did that come from? And you suddenly you're tracing back 20, 30, 40, 50 years earlier to something that
yeah.
was, you know, that led there.
But I think like a lot of us, there is a combination of influences, you know.
Sure.
It's you're listening when you're a teenager to everything from rock and roll and folk music and Brazilian music and avant-garde jazz, yeah. And you know, so it all comes together. So it kind of has for me. And then, you know, different groups call out different things from you. So that also has happened for me.
That's actually, before I wrap this up, there was something I wanted to ask just about this playing in a duets, playing duets like this, just the two of you. How does that inform your playing and sort of what you do and how you approach what you do? Is there something specifically you can say about that?
You mean how would we play differently in a duo than we would?
Yes. What does this specific combination do to the way you approach?
Yeah. It's so intimate. I don't know. There's a lot of things I could say about it. I mean, for example, one thing is not to be afraid of space.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, which feels really good, and just to let a note ring out and to not feel like we have to fill it in, because usually we have drummers there that are filling it in. And I think it comes out of solo playing too.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I like to do solo playing. I actually like to play hour-long concerts just with the bass.
Wow.
Because there's no help.
Yeah. Right.
Just up there and you have to play. And then you have to be strong, but then you have to be flexible, because then if I come and say, well, the way I heard it on the solo gig, that's it. I don't care about what you're doing. That's not going to make for a group. It's all about putting all that stuff, just forget all that, and just make each other sound good. So the nice thing about this is that we have more responsibility and we also have more freedom.
Yes.
You know? So it's freedom and responsibility. Who would have thought, right?
Right.
Yeah. So we kind of do both. It's sort of a metaphor for all partnerships, really.
Yeah, isn't that true? Anybody have any questions? Yes?
I just wonder what your background is.
Mine?
Your music background. What led you to do this?
Oh, what led me to do this? I'm also a musician, and I have a couple degrees in music, and I write a lot for television and film, and I play music live, and I was actually playing downstairs at the stage downstairs right after this club opened, and wandered up here and saw this beautiful room and thought, what are they doing here? And they hadn't yet figured it out, and so I talked to the management, because immediately the light went off and I thought, gorgeous room for jazz, what if I did you started a jazz series here? And I have a recording studio, so I bring all this gear every week, and my buddy Carl was nice enough to, because he's got a background in video, he was nice enough to help me figure out the video end of it, and so that's what we do, but that's me.
That's great.
I want to give these guys a break. Please do stick around. There's another full set of music. And next week, by the way, next week, Elaine Dame, wonderful singer, with Neil Alger, fantastic guitarist. So just another duet like that. And it's going to be absolutely lovely. And I will not be here. I am going to be traveling next week. I'm actually going to be playing in Los Angeles. So, but Don Sternberg will be here guest hosting. So expect some fun times next week. Thanks so much to John and Larry. God, what a great, great evening. And please do stick around. Please do stick around.
Looks like we lost Jimmy. He went home, huh?
Yeah.
You talked to him?
Yeah, he loved
you. He seemed like, yeah, sorry to get sick, but. Yeah.
Folks, thanks so much for sticking around. I was going to tell you again, just as a reminder, please do take these table cards with you if you like. They will give you information about what's coming up. I think actually there's not too much information on these cards. We've got only one more week and then Thanksgiving. Of course, we won't have a show on Thanksgiving. But you can come back next week and hear Elaine Dame, fantastic singer with Neil Alger, who is just an extraordinary guitarist. So they will be next week, Thanksgiving off, and then we're into December. And then once again, we have this great opportunity that's coming up. We'll have a holiday show on WDCB, which will be aired a couple times, of performers that have performed here at the Whiskey Lounge, three different acts. One of them is John Moulder here. And then starting in January, we're going to have a weekly radio show. Every Tuesday night, 7 to 8 p.m. on WDCB will be shows from here. We're naming the show Chicago Jazz Live, and it will be edited versions of these shows. So, again, thanks so much for sticking around. Thanks for listening. And we're going to turn it back over again to John Moulder and the great Larry Gray.
So we're going to start the set off with an original by John Moulder that he calls Pedals. Not pedals, P-E-D-A-L-S, pedals. I'm not sure what he means, but I'm not going to ask him.
I thought you would. So the reason I gave it that title, if it was pedals, right, you would think it was like flower petals, but this is more like a pedal bass, actually. You know, like different pedal points, like, you know, pedaling, that kind of thing. That's kind of what I was thinking, even though I kind of told Larry not to necessarily pedal the whole time through, but he has great instincts, so I know he'll work it.
So I can't just play low E.
Yeah, the whole time I know. So here goes. Thank you. All right, so we're going to continue with a lovely standard we like to play with a lovely sentiment by Cole Porter called I Love You. Thank you. the mirror tune? Just one tune,
okay,
and then.
Okay.
And, going to do another composition by Leary. This is one's intrigued me from the start. It's, tell the title, Leary.
Forgetting it, but it's, yeah, and the kind of concept.
Okay.
So, this, oh, there we are, okay. Is that on? Okay, yeah. So this is part of a suite that I did a few years back for a different group, a really interesting group that I have called Wilkerson Gray Ra, which is Ed Wilkerson and Avril Ra and myself. So it's Ed plays clarinet and saxophone, and Avril's a drummer and percussionist. We took it over to Poland in November, and we played this extended suite that I wrote. And in the middle of it, of the suite, which is pretty out there, pretty interesting, a lot of improvisation going on, there's this little waltz that kind of the other movements frame it, and that's what we're going to do for you tonight. And I'll just say the title. It's Memory Mirror Waltz. So I don't know. Do I want to tell them? No, let them hear it.
Just like that.
Okay. No, let them hear it. They'll hear it. They'll like it. It's got a, yeah, you'll see. Okay. Memory Mirror Waltz. Thank you.
How about one play window standard? Can you do that? Or you have another thing in mind?
No, I just want to hear you play some songs.
How are we on time, Steve? This is not really, I guess it's not, it's become kind of a standard, hasn't it? I mean, at this point, something in the 1960s, I would imagine, by Chick Corea. And it's a song we like to do called Windows. So hope you enjoy it. I'll just kind of vamp out from a B minor. You can solo.
Okay. Is that cool?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody. So great to have you here tonight. Steve.
Thanks so much for coming out this evening, folks. John Moulder, Larry Gray. How about it? What a completely transporting evening. Thanks so much, you guys. This was just such a blast. And thanks to all of you for sticking around. Thanks for supporting this. We really, again, we couldn't do this without human beings in the room. And it would be a totally different experience, believe me. So have a great evening. And please tell your friends and come back. Yeah. Have a great night.
Thank you. Thanks, Steve. Yeah. Thank you, Steve.
Thanks so much for having us.
Yeah, John.